check me out at www.donaminis.com for more podcasts, awesome hardcore trap, and some dope ass music visuals done by yours truly. Now let's get to this shit. All right, it all started for me with Sarai. I was about 12 years old in Richmond, Virginia. The year was 2003. Clips had ruled the summer. 50 Cent had smashed the school year. And as we were getting towards the new summer ahead, a new artist had came on the scene. Cue the music. Yo, when this song first came on the scene in 2003, it was a hit, at least in Virginia. Like, I would end up hearing this song for the whole fucking summer. Almost as much as Ja Rule's Down For You the summer before that. Almost as much as 50's P.I.M.P. that summer. And subliminal brainwashing by commercial band radio aside, I honestly really like this song. I love the beat. I love the vocals. I love the hook. I love the MC's flow. That shit was just off the chain. But then I realized something. This song was never played on the hip hop station in Richmond, Power 92 or 106.5 The Beat. It was only played on Q94, the pop station. I assume this was due to the artist's relationship with the station. Maybe she or her representation was cool with the people at the pop station, or maybe this artist was local and that specific station was playing only local artists. Anyway, when I finally saw the music video debut on MTV, the reason for the pop station grouping was abundantly clear. The reason she was only on the pop radio station and not the rap radio station was she was white.
Squeeze me?
Oh no, you
did. I for one was surprised that she was white. I assume this was just a person that didn't have a face or a race assigned to it, as silly as it sounds. At the very least, since it was hip-hop, I automatically assumed she was a black chick, maybe. I remember thinking that this was somehow wrong. It was weird also that she was only on a pop station and only on MTV for that matter, and not BET. This whole thing seemed racist and put in place by powers that be that my 8th grade mind could not comprehend existing at that time. But years later, while watching a music documentary, I was brought back to Sarai. I was watching a New Kids on the Block documentary, I don't fucking know why, and I learned that their first single, whatever it was shunned by mainstream R&B radio stations. They thought that they had a failure on their hands as a single until the manager of New Kids on the Block gave the song to a pop station, and then Eureka. He learned that the song wasn't actually R&B, even though it sounded like it. It was pop. You know why it was considered pop? Because New Kids on the Block were white. And I guess they were supposed to sing pop or pop R&B.
I think it's like, you know, again, like back to like my thing, it's just like, I don't know why. Why should the black stations play the white music? I don't know.
But it wasn't white music. It was literally a song.
But okay, a white artist.
But I didn't even know.
I just feel like, I don't know.
I talked to rapper and DJ Princess Superstar about this issue to get her opinion on Sarai and my single rap female theory. I'm so obsessed with this shit. The not so quite phenomenon of white chicks rapping and you know how it's accepted more nowadays, that I even made a trailer for a potential documentary about the subject.
The very first number one rap song to top was Debbie Harry. Since the beginning of the current decade, hip hop has gone through a metamorphosis of sorts, you know, adapting the influence of various outside genres, ideals, and movements, you know, making them its own. You know, the idea of a rapper being a certain type of person is all but gone.
I even had dramatic timpanis in that bitch and everything. In recent years, an influx of rappers from all ethnicities and backgrounds have gravitated to the genre. The likes of Macklemore, Asher Roth, Mac Miller, Machine Gun Kelly, and others. have prominently established themselves outside of the stereotypical black male archetype.
The question that's begging to be asked, however, is when would this all-boys club turn towards the female spectrum?
Single Rap Female asks this question and a multitude of more, man, bringing to the forefront the issues of race, gender bias, conflicting concepts of what hip-hop should be, and asking why aren't hip-hop's fans, a large percentage of white women, reflected in hip-hop's performers, which is mostly made up of black men.
Yeah, I asked some tough questions, man. So I found out that, you know, Sarai and Iggy weren't the first, you know, white female rappers doing this shit. It's hella motherfuckers that came before and paved the way for people like Iggy to be successful.
There was Tari B. Yeah, Tari B. And she was Eazy's girl. Well, right. Eminem came later, actually. Eminem was doing his thing, but like I actually put out records before Eminem. Wow. So
very novel.
It was, yeah, but yeah, exactly. Well,
Princess Superstar, an MC with over 20 years in the game, faced a bunch of adversity in her stretch for stardom due to her race and her gender.
I had a record label tell me, like, why are you trying to do hip hop? Like, are you, that's weird. And then back then it was weird.
And they didn't think they could sell it or anything?
Yeah, not at all. And early 90s, like, no. I got booed.
Really?
Spin Magazine called me racist for even wanting to rap.
Wow. Really?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that was my first record. They were like, oh. And people were mad that I was rapping.
It was really
a white woman, and you know, people hated it. I got booed a lot. I remember once I opened up for NERD, Pharrell, and it was a day like this, like mad hot. It was August, and it was an outdoor concert, and Pharrell was like bringing with him like Busta Rhymes and like Diddy, like everybody was there, and then like I came on, and I was like, hey, what's up? And the whole crowd was like, boo! And I was like, oh my god. And you know, I wanted to quit. I mean, you know, you're a human being, and to like get booed and shit, you know, and especially because like I loved hip hop. Like I felt entitled to do it just because I loved it.
Give me a black goddess sister. I can't resist her. No stringy haired, blonde haired, blue eyed, pale skin, buttermilk complexion, grafted, recessive, depressive, ironing board backside, straight up and straight down. No frills, no thrills, miss 6 o'clock. Subject to have the itch. Butanoid, caucasoid, white cave bitch.
These back, white bitch, I don't play that. When I first heard Ice Cube's Cave Bitch, I took it for what it was. An Afrocentric ode to black excellence in an era of adversity. It was also a time when, for once, black men could say basically whatever they wanted about whatever they wanted and not get persecuted for it, essentially. But it was more like the more fucked up you made it, the more money you got. And all of this on a major platform that garnered worldwide attention by a genre many considered to be a fad, hip-hop. And I understand it was the early 90s. Gangsta rap reigned supreme, black consciousness was a part of hip-hop like it is now, you know, at least it's coming back. The Rodney King riots were still in America's subconscious, especially black America. Ice Cube, he was the king of not giving a damn about what white people thought. I mean, he probably still is. But even though I understood this classic song and the context in which it was released, I couldn't help but feel bad for white people who heard it. I mean, this shit is pretty cold.
I mean, the fucked up thing about it is I probably would like that song if I heard it. I don't know. Do you know what I mean? Like, I this is fucked up, but I think if the beat is good, I probably would like it and know that that's just something that Ice Cube had to get off his chest, and that's where he stands, or that's how he felt that day, you know? I bet we'd probably have a really good time if we had a joint or a drink together, you know?
I spoke with Cat Hartwell of the 90s hip-hop and dance group Fannypack to get her opinion. I mean, she was a rapper who came up in the industry around the same time this song was made.
I don't know. I feel like that's where he was at in 1993, and there's a lot of shit. And maybe he still feels that way, but especially in 1993.
And I don't really believe in what some call reverse racism because of a ton of reasons, including the systemic after effects of centuries of American slavery. But I don't know, bro. This shit just made me feel bad to listen to.
White cave bitch.
We will make America strong again. We will make America proud again. We will make America safe again. And we will make America great again. God bless you and good night. I love you.
As of right now, I feel something I haven't felt my entire life. The tension of race at an all-time high. My parents, they were older. They're from Martin Luther King's generation and remember segregation vividly and dealt with being called nigger when they were young on the daily, amongst a bunch of other racist bullshit. And I have friends my age who are callous to certain quote-unquote white shit because of how they were raised. But me, I always liked supposed white shit. I was raised around white folks and I didn't see what my parents or family from the inner city were saying. I mean, I felt bad for white folks after hearing this song, but that's only because of my personal experiences. I think if Ice Cube had the same upbringing as me, he probably would have never wrote that song.
It's just like, again, I feel like there is a total inequality in this country that's totally fucked up. And I'm not, and like, I mean, for me to be like, fuck that, I should be on the Black station. It's like, what am I going to do? Wear a shirt, White Lives Matter? Like, I don't think so, right? Like, so that's...
But now it's like the early 90s again. Black people are speaking out against old whitey, and I don't know why, but when I see my white friends get offended on social media, I don't know. I don't think I feel like I felt when I heard Cave Bitch just a few years ago. I mean, if anything, I may make a song like Cave Bitch now. Maybe a bit more PC, like Cave Person or Cave Human. But why make a song like Cave Bitch at all? Why not Cave Man? I guess disrespecting women, in particular black women in hip-hop, is the norm. Maybe Cube thought it was only right to disrespect white women too, for good measure. I mean, there is Horny Little Devil, which is targeted to white men with the same rage as Cave Bitch. Or is it all a deep-rooted hate for all women by a male-dominated genre that makes a song like this happen? When it comes to songs disrespecting women, hip-hop has that in abundance. But why is this one of the only ones targeting white women, and why hasn't there been one like this since? And why do I give a fuck? I don't know. I'm not the only one who thinks this song is kind of fucked up. There's a post in a Coachella message board talking about how racist and sexist the song is and how they couldn't believe Ice Cube could make something so hateful. Unfortunately, it's a message board, a Coachella message board. I didn't even know that was a thing. When I first started this single rap female thing, white girls rapping, one of the first people I hit up was Terry B. She was one of the first women rappers, and she was signed to Ruthless Records in the early 90s. The same time Cube wrote this, I had this fantasy that Terry could rap the first verse of Cave Bitch for the intro to my documentary. I mean, that shit would be dope, right? I mean, like, kind of coming full circle with a white chick rapping about how white chicks suck, but ironically, of course. And, I mean, I think it would only be right since Cube and Easy had that falling out, and hey, Terry released her album, Power of a Woman, a few years before Cube released Cave Bitch. Maybe he was writing this with her in mind. Or maybe not, maybe I'm reaching. When I hit up Terry B on Facebook, she was all for talking to me until her lawyer told her to chill because of her book that she's coming out with. Apparently she has some tell-all stuff about Dr. Dre, him being physically abusive with her, and this isn't the first time I've heard about Dre and abusing women. Surviving Compton, anybody?
Can't work like this, Dre.
You sing it like you feel it, I'ma kick your ass.
One thing I've grown to hate more than anything, even the racist, is a woman beater. But damn, Dr. Dre, he's like one of my biggest influences and perhaps one of the biggest influences in hip-hop, period. I mean, what does that say about hip-hop? Up in the game wearing khakis, not Kangol, strangling hoes. When asked about it in most interviews, I just laugh. Now I vacate with hoes with a gang of ass. One feed me mango. I'm not about to be up in this rap game, being Mexican cha-cha. Q snow the product. She doesn't sex it up like Iggy or Nicki or Cardi or Meg. She's beautiful and keeps it hip-hop, often wearing her trademark woke scully. It's pretty rare to find her in a dress. She's all about the flows. I'm really thinking that lately this game just like to push hoes, cause I've been giving y'all bars for days and I swear to y'all the Lord knows. And who knows, a lot of the reasons why people hated Yoko. Was it because she was an Asian lady who spoke what was on her mind?
And Yoko Ono is another person who has like weird experimental music where she's kind of rapping, you know? Mm-hmm. She's like talking. It's minimalist, but it's weird. And like, you know, again, I think that there's early ideas of what rapping is that can be found in unexpected places.
I mean, I can't help it, man. I feel bad when I hear this song. I feel bad for white people who hear it. Like, at the same time, I feel like a song like this has to be made, though, if only to offset centuries of black hate in a super small way. I still think another Cave Bitch needs to be made. Maybe it can be made by Iggy Azalea or Winnie or someone like that. Because whether you construe the words of this song as hateful or just, there must be an understanding of a larger issue than racism at hand. One of sexism. Black women had it worse during slavery than men. They did all the same work as men. They got whipped and treated the same, all at the same time while being raped and sold and traded like cattle away from their families, having their children sold. Maybe Cube didn't do this song out of a hate for the white woman. Maybe he did it from a source of love for the black woman.
Here's what I want you to say. I want you to say, I apologize. Beautiful black woman, mother of the earth, queen of the universe.
I'm sorry, I apologize, black mother of
get
the
it
universe.
Right. Yeah, get it right.
Man, I can't remember all that. I'm sorry.